Thank you all for showing up. This is a joyous occasion. I'm seeing many of you in person for the first time, and it's got to be 4 years. The last presentation I gave before Green Mountain Academy was unfortunately via Zoom, and it was very unfortunate because my forecast actually proved accurate, which isn't always the case. And I will tell you, I should also thank the library and GNAT for filming this. It is always a surprise that you invite me back, because my forecasts have not always been accurate. And I did take time to actually look up my previous appearances here to get a sort of a track record to see whether you're getting your money's worth or not. And I will tell you, this is the third time I've given this talk. They trot me out every 2 years. I go around the state and talk about what I think is going to happen. And the forecast I'm going to give you has changed dramatically since the previous two versions of this talk, in a way that I think many of you, not all of you, will find quite pleasing. And we'll get to that. But why should you listen to me at all? So here I am. Actually, that's my picture from when I last did my presidential talk. But I just thought I'd dredge up my previous appearances and predictions here. So dating back, I think I may have actually come in earlier than 2010. Gloria would know, but I can't remember that far back. I can't even remember what I did last week. But I can tell you, from 2010, 2014, and 2018, my presentations here for midterm, on the left are the predictions I made in this forum, and on the right are the actual House results. That's not too bad. And I will say, you can applaud, sure, go ahead. you notice we're not saying anything about the presidential forecast here. It's a midterm. I happen to do better on midterms. The House, of course, is somewhat easier to predict, as I'll explain to you in a moment, because there's 435 House seats. That's a big N, and that allows us to really lends itself to more precise estimates of the House forecast. But I've also forecast the Senate. Haven't done that bad either. So 2010, 2014, 2018, the most recent 2018, I was off by a couple of seats. So that's all a way of saying, if I screw this one up, I did okay in the previous one, so cut me some slack. So what is the forecast? I'll get to it, but I want to sort of take you through the logic behind these forecasts and introduce you to some political science forecast models. Those of you who have come to my talks before will be familiar with some of what I have to say here. I'm repeating stuff. For the rest of you, I encourage you to stop me at any point. I tend to go rather quickly through these slides, and if you have particular questions or you need a clarification about some of the logic I'm throwing at you, just raise your hand and scream at me, and I'm glad to stop and talk about it. So what's at stake here? In this talk, I will talk about the electoral context, and then I'll introduce you to something called the midterm loss phenomenon. It is as close to a regularity that we have in politics that there is. And I'll explain various ways of explaining that phenomenon, different theories of elections. And then I'll talk about, very briefly, some developments that might alter these projections. And finally, I'll give you the forecast. Actually, I think I've reversed 3 and 4. I think I'll give you the forecast and then some projections that may alter them. And finally, if the forecast is right, some implications going forward between 2022 and our next presidential election, 2024. So in the coming midterm election in November, there are 435 House seats up. Currently, the House Democrats control a majority, as you know, 219 seats. Republicans have 2,011. Depending on how you fill those vacancies, Republicans are going to need to gain or flip about 8 seats to get a bare majority here. Of course, there are vacancies here, and that number will switch depending on how those vacancies are filled. And then there's the Senate. Currently, the Senate is split 50-50. Kamala Harris, the vice president, has cast the tie-breaking vote in numerous occasions here because the Senate is deeply polarized and you're finding very little movement across the aisle on behalf of either party. Indeed, much of the, if there is negotiation going on, it's within the Democratic Party, particularly Kirsten Sinema and Joe Manchin, in order for the Democrats to hold on to their 50-seat quote-unquote majority. In this fall, the Democrats are defending 14 seats while the Republicans are defending 20. Now keep in mind, as I'll show you in a moment, those are the number of seats that are up for grabs, but most of those seats really have no chance of flipping from one party to the other. They're just not competitive at all. There's really only a very small number of seats that are genuinely competitive in this electoral cycle, and I'll take you through that. But that's the context. If we want to look graphically here at the map, this is the current distribution, and it looks like the Republicans are overwhelmingly in the majority here, but of course that reflects the fact that each House district has to have roughly the same number of individuals, about 700,000. And if you look here very carefully, you can see the Democrats' seats are in high density, high population areas, New York and LA and San Diego. And what that means is that those districts are geographically much smaller in size, whereas the Republicans are representing seats that are more rural, less population, and so geographically they have much more territory. And that reflects partly this urban-rural divide that is mapped onto other divides in our country that has exacerbated the polarization we're seeing. Now I'm going to get back to this map because it has important implications for why the Republicans have a built-in structural advantage heading into November. And it has a lot to do with how we allocate seats, which is we use first-past-the-post voting. That is, which of the two candidates gets the most votes, doesn't even matter how much they win by, they're gonna get that seat. And as I'll show you in a moment, that bias favors the Republican Party, and I'll explain that logic. The Senate, not, of course, every state Senate delegation is up for election this year. There are 34 plus a special election. So there are a number of seats here where there will be no election. 30 Republicans not up, 36 Democrats not up. So there's 20 Republican seats currently held by Republicans and 14 Democrats, but the most important ones are these ones that have black outlines. Those are seats in which the current incumbent is retiring. Those are the most competitive seats, the ones in which most of the money will be spent here. Pennsylvania, of course, a big one here. Ohio, probably not going to be that competitive. J.D. Vance will probably win that. Missouri, probably not competitive. North Carolina, I'm sorry, J.D. Vance, did I get some? Only in America, folks, only in America. North Carolina, very competitive. And of course, Alabama, probably not competitive at all. We'll run through some of these specific Senate races in just a moment. So if we think about Senate races that are toss-ups, in which we really cannot tell you with any certainty who's going to win, there's probably six here. Arizona, Mark Kelly, who won a special election there and is now running for re-election in his own right. Ralph Warnock, who, again, a surprise, won a special election in Georgia, in part because Donald Trump complained so much about allegations of voter fraud. Republicans actually did not turn out in that race, and it flipped to the Democrats. So Donald Trump sort of hoisted on his own petard, or at least the party. Nevada, Catherine Cortez Mastro. Wisconsin, Ron Johnson running for his third term and in for a real tough fight. And as we said, North Carolina and Pennsylvania are open seats. There's a couple others that pundits frequently talk about as open. If you have been watching television, you've been seeing Maggie Hassan running ads nonstop. That's because she anticipates a competitive race, but we don't know who her opponent will be yet in New Hampshire. I suspect that she, as an incumbent, will probably win. And then there's a couple of races I mentioned. The open seat in Ohio, J.D. Vance, Ohio, is trending Republican in recent elections. J.D. Vance is probably going to win that. And Marco Rubio, facing Val Demings in Florida, Rubio probably has the advantage there. I'm going to spend most of my time talking about the House. The House is much more theoretically interesting. The Senate, a lot of the outcome really depends on factors that we can't predict. As I'll point out, one of the things the Republicans have done in recent years is snatch defeat from the jaws of victory by running what some have described as a clown show in choosing their candidates for the Senate seats. And I'll talk about some of that in just a moment. But here's the midterm loss phenomenon I pointed out. And it's simply this, that in the first midterm election after a presidential election, almost without fail, the party of the president loses seats. Now, the extent of the seat loss varies dramatically, but they always lose seats, with rare exceptions. Three exceptions, really, if you think about this map dating back to the Roosevelt administration. Franklin Roosevelt, after election in winning in 1932, his party actually gained seats in the midterms in 1934. And then we have to go all the way to 1998, the second midterm in the Clinton administration, and 2002, the first midterm in George W. Bush's administration, and both the Democrats and the Republicans in those elections gained seats. Otherwise, the president's party loses seats, sometimes a lot of seats. So in 2010, Barack Obama's first midterm, Democrats suffered that shellacking, 63 seats. Donald Trump, his first midterm, 2018, they lost 40 seats. So if history is any indication, the Democrats are going to lose seats this fall. The question is, how many are they going to lose, and will they lose their majority? But this begs the question, why? And the short answer is there's three different explanations which are mutually overlapping that political scientists like to talk about. But just to test your knowledge, anybody have any idea why 98 and 2002 might be outliers here? Clinton impeachment. 1998, Clinton impeachment. And 2002, 9/11. So if we have an impeachment between now and November, or, God forbid, a terrorist strike, all my forecasts are out the window. But I'm not anticipating either of those, what we might call black swan events. No, by the way, this midterm loss phenomenon also affects the Senate, although not quite as regularly, but 18 of 25 midterms in this period, the president's party lost seats. There have been exceptions. Interestingly enough, Donald Trump and the Republicans actually gained seats in 2018. You recall my prediction. I said there was going to be a wash that year, and I was wrong. The Republicans gained two seats. As I said, the Senate is a little more idiosyncratic, but it is still governed to a certain degree by these same midterm loss phenomenon. Now, when I present my political science forecast, I am going to do so based on theories. Remember, I'm a political scientist, emphasis on scientist. We have pretense of actually understanding politics scientifically. I know that brings a lot of chuckles to you, but bear with me and humor me. So what I'm going to present is an actual explanation for why I think Democrats will lose seats this fall. If you don't care about theory and you don't care about science, you can get up and leave right now and go home and watch the home cooking station, because you can get perfectly good predictions by people like Charlie Cook, Stuart Rothenberg, and Larry Sabato. These are what I call smart political pundits, and they will just literally go in each seat and they will look at polling and they'll talk to people, and intuitively, because they're very smart guys, they will make predictions. They have no theory about why this is happening. They're just telling you who's going to win. Or you can read Nate Silver or other pundits who look at polling data. And again, they have no theory. They just look at the polling data. They pick their finger in the wind. They detect which way the wind is coming, and they say, oh, a storm is brewing. But again, there's no theory. So I'm going to present a theory. See, you're getting your money's worth already. Science. This is real science, folks. All right, and what are these theories? There's three of them. the surge and decline thesis, which focuses our attention on the difference between the voting pool in a presidential election and the voting pool in a midterm. The referendum on the president theory, which suggests midterms are largely a referendum on the incumbent president or the incumbent president's party. And finally, the balancing argument. This has come into play in recent elections as Congress has become more polarized and the public has remained relatively centrist. That's a whole other topic. Americans are increasingly reluctant to entrust power to any party for any length of time. That's the balancing argument. I'm going to draw on all three of these theories to make predictions about the fall before putting them all together and giving you my final prediction. But I just wanted to present these, what we would call theories. The surge and decline theory is quite simple. It says during a presidential election year, there is a surge of voters. Individuals, often many who don't pay much attention to politics otherwise, they don't go to rallies, they don't contribute to candidates, they don't write letters, they just vote, and they only vote in presidential election years. And of these, a big portion are independents who don't strongly ally with either party and normally would pay no attention to politics, but they will come out in a presidential election year. They are the ones that provide the volatility to our political system because independents will often flip back and forth between parties from election to election. In the midterm, these voters stay home. Most of them are independents. That's the decline. We can see this graphically. This is turnout of eligible voters, so people who are of legal age and can vote, even if they're not registered. This is the percentage of them that vote in presidential election years, the blue line, and in midterms. And you can see, even in an extraordinary year like 2018, when we had an extraordinarily high turnout of eligible voters, the highest we've had really since the early 1900s, it nonetheless was still far below the turnout in the 2016 presidential election, which was about 60%. So we're talking about a surge or a decline of anywhere between 10 to 20% in a midterm. It drops off. Why is that important? Because most of that drop-off occurs among voters who voted for the winning presidential candidate in the presidential election. They don't show up in the midterm, and that means they don't vote for the president's party, because we know people, most people vote a straight party ticket. If you're going to vote for Joe Biden, you're going to vote for Democrats down ticket in the House and the Senate race. They disproportionately decide not to vote in the midterm. So that's one explanation for why Democrats are probably going to do worse. We can estimate how big that decline will be because we know a large part of that decline is among self-defined independents. We ask individuals, do you associate with, call yourself a Democrat, a Republican, or an independent? And of those percentage that call themselves independent, we ask, do you lean one way or the other? Well, we know those people who say, no, I don't lean, I'm really into pure independent. Those are the ones who are most responsive to the mood of the moment. And since 1980, each percentage point advantage that the president, victor now, has among independents is associated with a subsequent loss of about 2.2 House seats. That's the decline. So all we have to do is figure out how many independents Joe Biden won relative to Donald Trump, and then multiply that by 2.2, and that'll tell us more or less how many House seats the Democrats will lose. Science, pretty simple, huh? That assumes, of course, that in November, things happen the way they've happened since 1980. A big assumption, but nonetheless. All right, Biden won independence by 14 points over Donald Trump in 2020. What does that predict? It predicts a gain of 31 seats for the Republicans in the midterm election, 31 seats. Remember I said they need about 10, 8 to 10 to get a majority. So this would give them more than enough for a majority here. Now that's just looking at that independence. There's other factors that we can talk about. How about theory number two, the referendum theory? That theory says The midterm is often a referendum on perceptions of how well the president has done in the previous 2 years. And generally speaking, during those 2 years, presidents make more enemies than friends. They tend to make policy choices that will eventually lead to a decline in approval that weakens their appeal, it weakens their party's brand name, and as a result, individual members of the House and the Senate running on that party brand suffer as a consequence of this referendum on the president. So how popular is Joe Biden? Not very popular. The black line is his disapproval. The red line is his approval. This is actually an aggregate approval. So it is the combination of many different polls. I've dropped the confidence intervals here just so you can see the line. You can see back somewhere where he decided to pull out of Afghanistan and then we got hit with Omicron. His disapproval numbers started going up, but they've remained up ever since. However, if you look at the tail end there, he's actually gained ground over the last 2 months. Largely, we think, is a product of Congress has actually passed some significant bills, including the so-called Anti-Inflation Act, which is probably inflationary, but it still is, for Democrats, it is a good thing. It may be a good thing for Republicans as well. We'll have to see. So you can see his approval rating has jumped from a down low in Trump levels to, well, high Trump levels, but 36 to about 42. And his disapproval ratings has dropped from a high of 56 down to about 54. So he's only underwater by about 13 percentage points, where 2 months ago he was closer to 15 to 16 percentage points. Every bit helps, folks. In our referendum theory, just to give you a sense, here's Biden. Gallup has him at 44. That's very close in August to where Trump was, Obama, and G.W. Bush. So that's good. He's gaining, right? Well, here's the midterm loss for those presidents, 30, 63, 13, and 40. So even though Biden is not as unpopular as he was 2 months ago, the raw numbers still say his party is in for a beating, if not a shellacking. They're going to lose seats. How many? Again, we can sort of look at the change in presidential approval rating. Biden, according to Gallup, has lost 14. We can correlate that. Particularly, he's underwater with independents. Remember, they're the volatile individuals, although fewer of them are going to vote. But I will point out, again, there's been stability here. He couldn't go much lower among Republicans. He was among 90% approval rating, dropping down to 70 in low 80s now. But he sort of stabilized here. But if you look at that right there, that minus 14 in approval rating, and you sort of look at where he is now, say 42, 43, this is the approval rating of presidents. And this is the share of percentage of the House vote. Now we're looking at the popular vote, so all votes for Republican candidates combined, all votes for Democrats combined. So if you look at all previous elections dating back to the beginning of the Clinton administration here in 1992, so you graph a point, where was Bush's approval rating and how did he do in terms of popular support for his Republican Party, Clinton, and then you sort of draw a line, call this a regression line, and you project where somebody who has Biden's approval rating is, where that means in terms of the popular vote now, not the seats yet, the popular vote, it works out roughly to the Republicans winning about 53% of the popular vote compared to Democrats winning 47. Again, a rough calculation, maybe a little more, maybe a little less. But of course, we don't elect the House by the popular vote, so we have to translate that 53% of Republican total vote into seats. And this is where the Republican bias that I talked about earlier comes into play. Remember, we select our House members using something called single member simple plurality. What that means is there's one member per district. We have Peter Welch. Vermont is a district, that's it. And whoever wins the fall election in Vermont, Peter Welch, or his opponent, anybody know who that is? What's that? No. It's Liam. No, that's the House one. Actually, you might be right. Yeah, it is Malloy. Sorry. DePoy Malloy. I'm getting my House races confused with the Senate race. That's right. Peter is now running for the Senate. So never mind Peter. We're talking about the House race. I've confused you. But the point is this. You just have to get one vote more than your opponent, and you win the race. Simple plurality. And we take that for granted, but most nations in the world don't do that. What this means is if somebody finishes 1 point behind Becca Ballant in the House, they don't get any representation in Congress. But that's not how it works in most of the world. You can finish a close second and your party will get representation because in most nations, elect your legislative assembly using something called proportional representation. We do not. We use single member, simple plurality. Why do I spend time telling you this? Because it influences the results in a way that whichever party wins the most popular votes is going to win more than that proportion of House seats. In other words, there's an advantage built in here by the fact that finishing second place gets you nothing. All those votes are wasted. And so what we see here historically, going back to 1946, is that the difference between the seat share and the vote share won by the majority party on average is about 5%, a little bit more, 5.5%. What does that mean? That means if you win 53% of the House popular vote, as I predicted the Republicans will, you'll win about 58% of the House seats. And it's all an artifact of the way we allocate votes to seats. Single member, simple plurality. Now it varies. Some years that bias is less. Some years it's a lot more. It benefits whichever party happens to be in the majority. This year, most likely the Republicans. And this is where this structural advantage comes into play. Look at this map again. And what this suggests is that when Democrats win, they win by a lot. In other words, they're wasting votes because we don't care if you win with 51% of the vote or if you win with 91% of the vote. You only get one seat. Republicans, because they're in smaller areas, tend to win by smaller margins. In other words, they are more efficiently distributed. And so the wasted votes is much less. I'll give you an example. In 2014, the Democrats won a House seat for every 189,000 votes they received. The Republicans, in contrast, only needed 162,000. So Democrats had to get 20,000 more votes on average per district to win that seat. That is that structural bias that favors the Republicans. So when our forecast model, the referendum on Biden, predicts the Republicans are going to get 53% of the seat, of the vote, the popular vote, they're going to get a lot more in terms of the proportion of House seats. Generally speaking, 53% means 35 seat gain for the out party, in this case, the Republicans. So we've now showed you two models, and both of them have the Republicans winning a heck of a lot of seats, 32 and 35. One more model here, and then we'll go to my forecast. This is more of a way of thinking about the vote, but it doesn't give us a precise seat count. And it's the balancing theory. And the balancing theory has several different versions. We might call it the power corrupts theory, when voters rebel against one party control. So when one party is in control of the House, the Senate, and the White House, invariably the public says, we don't like that. So we're going to vote at least one of those chambers to the other party. We can't do that to the presidency in a midterm election. So it'll be the House or the Senate. Now that requires them to coordinate votes, but if enough people are following this logic, it follows that they will flip partisan control of either the Senate or the House this November. A related argument is we are moderate, generally as a people. Again, a whole nother talk. And we have two parties out there that are anything but. The Republicans are somewhere to the right of Attila the Hun. They're composed of a bunch of gun-toting, well, you know, the whole drill. Do I have to walk you through it? Okay, gun-toting, goose-stepping, Bible-thumping neo-Nazis. But the Democrats, those secular humanist baby-killing, tree-hugging eco-terrorists, are somewhere to the left of Mao Tse-sung. And here I am stuck in the middle with you, right? What am I gonna do? I'm gonna make sure neither of those wacko parties has unified control. I'm gonna balance off. That's ideological balancing. And related to that is institutional balancing. I view the presidency as performing a certain set of functions. I view Congress as a different set of functions. In the old days, when we were politically incorrect, we would say the presidency was the daddy institution. Congress was the mommy institution. Congress gave us benefits. The president protected us against evil things. Those gender stereotypes are, of course, outmoded. You won't hear me using them anymore. Can you delete that part of the program? Thank you. The point is we cast votes differently in a presidential election year than we do in a midterm election, and as a result, we tend to divide government again. Whatever you want to believe, that leads to an argument that since the Democrats have been in control for 2 years, whatever logic voters are going to use, they're going to be sure to take that control away from the Democrats. So the ideological argument says, look it, this is the House, the red line. This is the Senate, the blue line. And what these are measuring is the gap between the median member of the Republican caucus and the median member of the Democratic caucus in the House and the Senate. And by median member, I mean if you arrayed them all along a line ideologically and said, here's the center of gravity in the Republican Party, here's the center of gravity of the Democratic Party, and how far apart are they ideologically? You can see we are as far apart today, and this only brings us to 2016, as we have been since really in Reconstruction. We have two parties that can't agree on anything, deeply polarized. And of course the public, as a result, doesn't trust either of them. And that's the ideological balancing theory, and we have a lot of evidence that that balancing takes place. For instance, if we look at polling data, and as people begin to tune into a midterm election, increasingly, as more and more people tell pollsters who they're going to vote for, it's the out party that gains support. Because people are thinking, who am I going to vote for? Well, I'm going to vote for the party that's not in control of the major institutions. So there's a lot of evidence to suggest that balancing takes place. There's other evidence. I've talked about this before. We are in an extraordinary period of indecision on the vote part of the voters. If you think about a simple measure of partisan control, who has a majority in the House and the Senate, and who holds the presidency? And we think about two parties, three institutions, there's eight possible configurations. And I won't run through them, but you could have all Republicans, you could have all Democrats, you could have Republicans in the president of the House and the Democrat and so on. Well, the point is we have run through seven of those eight possible configurations. The American people have not entrusted any party to control all three branches of government for longer than 2 years for the last two decades. They just don't trust them. And an interesting fact, had the Republicans not shot themselves in the foot in Georgia in those special elections by claiming fraud, which depressed Republican turnout, and the Republicans turned out the way they normally do, they would have won that seat, they would have controlled the Senate, and we would have had the trifecta. We would have cycled through every single possible, all eight configurations. So there's a lot of evidence here that American, for whatever reason, are balancing institutional control here. Since the disputed 2000 election, we have experienced 7 of the 8 possible configurations. No single configuration has lasted a full presidential term. Most have only lasted 2 years. So I'm not going to use balancing to give you a precise seat prediction, but I am going to use it to tell you Democrats are going to lose control of one of those two institutions, the Senate or the House, and perhaps both. Okay. You recognize them, of course. My drawing's not that good. All right. So let me summarize. The surge and decline model says the Republicans are going to gain 35 seats. The referendum on Biden model says the Republicans are going to gain 32 seats. The balancing model, no clear seat prediction, but Democrats will lose their House majority. You're depressed. Some of you are depressed. Some of you are secretly cheering. I won't presume to know who is who. But if you are depressed, let me cheer you up with some possible good news for Democrats. First, there is an argument you made that Democrats will not lose 30 or more seats. And the reason is because in those past elections, which we utilize to predict the current election, in many of those elections, the Democrats' losses came because they had a lot more seats under control, and many more seats were vulnerable to being flipped. So remember I talked about the shellacking in 2010? We tend to forget they lost 63 seats, but they went into that election, with a 79-seat advantage. They only now have a 10-seat advantage. So they are, in effect, more likely to withstand a Republican surge of support among the voters. Because remember we talked about competitive races and races that aren't competitive? That 10-seat advantage, there are very few Democrats who are in vulnerable positions here. So the Republican wave, in order to gain 63 seats, has to be historically much higher than we've ever seen. In fact, in a normal wave year, it's going to be really hard for Republicans to flip 30 seats, simply because, for a lot of reasons that I'll talk about here, there just aren't that many competitive seats. So we can actually incorporate that into our model. And this is what Alan Abramowitz does. He actually has a very simple model. His model says, how many seats does the majority party control? And when you ask the voters who they're going to vote for, a Republican candidate or a Democratic candidate in the House, and we don't even ask them which candidate, just which party, those two factors alone have proved incredibly reliable in predicting the outcome of the midterm election. We call that the seats defended plus generic ballot model. We're not noted for being very imaginative in our titles, but reading down here, basically, in the generic ballot, any decrease in the margin for the president's party is expected to produce a swing of about 1.7 seats towards the other party. And every additional seat defended by the president's party leads to a loss of about half of a seat. In other words, the more seats you defend, the more likely you are going to lose seats. And the less popular your party is in the generic ballot, the more likely you are to lose seats. And that's all we need to know. Yes, question.
Does defend mean also defending seats that you have now that are being, from which people are retiring?
Yes, we just count that as your party controlling that seat, even though the individual stepped down. But that is a good point, because you've just pointed out an additional complicating factor, which is we know incumbents do better than novices when it runs for House. And so one of the things we want to look at is how many Democrat incumbents are stepping down and how many Republicans. And it turns out a lot more Democrats are stepping down than Republicans in the House. That does not bode well for Democrats. I'll get to that. All right, so let's just run this Abramowitz model. Here's past elections. This is his predicted change. And here's the actual House seat. And if they were all one-on-one, they'd fall right on this line. You can see each of these elections is a pretty good model. It's not perfect. There's some slippage. Some years, like 2002, we already talked about that. His model's way off, but of course that was after 9/11. But it's generally a good model. So what does it predict? With the current 11-seat advantage, the generic ballot, Democrats minus Republicans, varies in terms of the House seats and Senate seats it predicts. So if Democrats are up 10 in the generic ballot, we can expect them to actually gain seats, 2 seats this fall, and 3 Senate seats. If they're down 10, we can expect them to lose 32 and lose 1 Senate seat. Where are they? Well, 2 months ago, they were in a far different place than they are now. Here's where they are now. This is the generic ballot. The red is the percentage of people in multiple polls saying, I'm going to vote for the Republican candidate. And blue is the Democratic. When I started giving these talks, the generic ballot was about 4 to 5% in favor of Republicans. It's now practically tied. So if you go back to that, that predicts only a loss of 15 seats. Still going to lose their majority, but if other things come into play, you can at least go to bed that night praying to the electoral gods for a miracle, and it's actually a realistic prayer, as opposed to if it's -5, you've got no chance, or -10. So, what other factors might help Democrats, or help Republicans for that matter? 4 or 5 quick ones. Remember, this is the first midterm election after gerrymandering. Gerrymandering occurs every 10 years as a result of population shifts. We need to redraw our congressional district lines to ensure that the districts are the same size. That process is controlled by the parties. Each party tries to maximize the likelihood that they're going to elect their own individuals to the House and minimize the opposition. So this is the first election under the new map. We just completed that map literally a couple weeks ago, although there's still a couple of seats in New York that are being contested. Second, the enthusiasm gap. Which party supporters are more enthusiastic to vote? We know that's a predictor of turnout. Third, and this is particularly the case in the Senate, candidates matter. If you run a bunch of clowns, the results are going to be a joke on you. And finally, issues, and particularly what we might call the October surprise. Are there issues that have suddenly come into play that favor one party as opposed to the other? And you can see where I'm going with on that one. So let me briefly run through those. Gerrymandering. Again, it's almost impossible to predict the impact of these new redrawn lines, but if we kind of look at the presidential vote as a proxy for the two parties, and we compare the presidential vote in 2020 to what we think it might be under the new district lines, we think there are 188 districts that lean Biden. That's about a gain of 1 as a result of gerrymandering. There's 168 that would probably lean Trump. That's a gain of 10. Since 2020. So the Republicans probably came out a little bit ahead in the gerrymandering. There's a lot of uncertainty here. Basically, what we've seen here is a reduction in the number of competitive districts by about 11. Now note, that's a long-term trend. If we define competitive seats as a seat in which the presidential candidate in a prior election was within 5 percentage points of his opponent, and use that to define a competitive election, we can see gerrymandering after the most recent decennial census has largely resulted in a reduction of competitive seats. So by this metric, there's only about 40 seats in play in November. So gerrymandering has probably helped Republicans slightly, but what it's really done is helped incumbents. It's just taken more seats out of play. That's probably actually going to help Democrats, because it's going to dampen the effect of a Republican wave. So kind of a mixed bag. Here's a map that shows you sort of the difference between seats controlled by Republicans, probably 181, Democrats 156. These are seats that lean strongly or weakly to the Democrats, and these are probably the ones that are toss-ups, really, again, maybe 30. Interestingly, New York has a couple of them, Maine, some up in Washington and Oregon and California, but most of these races simply are not that competitive in the House. Last year, it looked like people were identifying as Republicans increasingly, as we see from the beginning of 2021 through the end of 2021, the percentage of individuals who called themselves Republicans went from 40 to 47, Democrats from 49 to 42. That bode well for the Republicans, but that has actually leveled off. If you look now, the percentage of Republicans has remained really steady, as have the Democrats. And of course, that doesn't ask people what independents think. And we know most people are independents. And it's hard to predict how they're going to vote. Enthusiasm. In previous elections, the party that had the advantage in the enthusiasm gap, we ask individuals, are you looking forward to vote? And this is the percentage saying they are more enthusiastic than usual. And you can see in each election, the party that had the most members saying they were enthusiastic typically won the majority of seats. Think of 2010 and the shellacking. Well, 63% of Republicans were enthusiastic, only 44% of Democrats. And conversely, in 2018, when Democrats picked up 40 seats, they led in the enthusiasm 61 to 58. Where are we on the enthusiasm? This, by the way, is matching up that enthusiasm with the actual seats gained. So the left bar is the enthusiasm gap, and the right bar is the actual gain in seats. So it's not a one-to-one correspondent, but generally, if a Democrat's leading the enthusiasm gap, they gain the most seats. Republicans, they gain the most seats. Right now, the Republicans have an advantage by 3 percentage points, but that has tightened. The other thing to note is both parties are really enthusiastic, which suggests turnout is going to be high. All right, issues and candidates. Don't they matter? Yes, they matter, particularly in the Senate. The major issues are the economy, and then there are other issues that have just come into play. Like immigration, January 6th, and of course the Supreme Court abortion decision. The problem with looking at the economy is I already showed you data on approval for the president, and a lot of that reflects the state of the economy. So it's not clear how much additional information we learn by looking, for instance, at inflation, and we see we have the highest annual inflation rate since 1981. That doesn't bode well for Democrats who are perceived to be in charge, but it's already kind of baked into our models when we look at Biden's approval. Consumer confidence is dropping. It's at the lowest levels that we've seen in over a decade. Again, doesn't help Democrats, but it's kind of baked in already. How about your point? And this is as of June now. I haven't updated this. 38 members of the House and the Senate have announced their retirement. Five of the Senate members are Republicans, one's a Democrat. In the House, 22 are Democrats, 10 are Republicans. So kind of a split verdict there if you're trying to read the tea leaves on which candidates anticipate that they're not going to be in the majority, so they're going to step down. Maybe we had a June surprise instead of an October surprise. The impact of abortion. If you ask individuals about their views towards abortion and the percent who claim that they favor legal abortion for any reason, it's gone up dramatically over the last couple of years, particularly since June. You might argue, and Democrats are hoping, that this issue will galvanize enough of those independents who normally would be on the fence but who are pro-abortion or pro-choice to decide, I'm going to vote, and I'm going to vote Democratic this year. The problem is, of course, is that's kind of misleading. If you really look at people's views on abortion, it's much more mixed than simply asking, are you pro-choice or pro-life? Most individuals are a mix of both. So it's not clear the abortion issue favors one party or the other. For instance, the state of Kansas had a referenda recently on whether they would amend their constitution to essentially say there is no constitutional right in Kansas to an abortion. And Kansas voters overwhelmingly voted against that. Well, that was interpreted by a lot of pundits to suggest that Kansas voters in a conservative state, a red state, if they were pro-choice, imagine how the rest of this country is going to go. Well, the problem is I had a student write a senior thesis, and despite the effort to interpret Kansas' vote as a backlash against the Supreme Court ruling in Dobbs, she actually did a survey of Kansas voters before Dobbs, and overwhelmingly, in about the same number that they actually voted in, her survey suggested Kansas voters were going to reject the state constitution. So didn't really reflect Dobbs at all. It reflected more the unwillingness of mostly moderate individuals to take an extreme view on abortion, which in this case would have basically outlawed abortion in Kansas had you supported it. Even conservatives are not extremists when it comes to abortion. Conservatives now in the broad public, not members of Congress. So I would read as much as a lot of people are into that Kansas vote as reflecting a backlash against Dobbs in the SCOTUS ruling. All right. The Senate. I've been ignoring the Senate because I have no idea what's going to happen. I have an idea. Remember the map here now of roughly 34 Senate seats, about a third, are up in 2022, including five open seats. If you really want to narrow down your focus, I think there are six seats, as I said earlier, that are in play. Two of those have open seats, one of them in this particular, the other one, North Carolina, may be in play. So Pennsylvania is the one where Mehmet Oz is against Fetterman. This was a Republican-controlled seat, but right now polling suggests that it's going to flip, and this would be a pickup for the Democrats. Ron Johnson running for a third term. He is the only Republican seeking re-election in a state Biden won in 2020. That does not bode well. He's behind in the polls, but I would also point out that Wisconsin has been trending Republican for years. Biden's victory was something of a fluke, a surprise. Nevada, in contrast, Republican Adam Laxalt, that is a very potent name in Nevada politics. And polls suggest he's running neck and neck with the incumbent Mazdeau. That could be a flip for Republicans. Georgia, Herschel Walker is engaged in something of a broken field run here. Polls show him neck and neck, believe it or not, in Georgia with the incumbent, Warnock. Arizona, Mark Kelly has opened up a sizable polling lead over Republican Blake Masters. And I don't really think Maggie Hassan has much to worry about here, but we simply don't know who the Republicans are running. Remember that generic ballot model? It also predicts Senate seats. And based on that zero, we would think actually the Democrats would pick up one seat in the Senate based on that.
What about Ohio?
I know this is hard to believe, but I don't think Ohio's in play. I think J.D. Vance is really the front runner there. Polls have him up between 5 and 7%. Ohio has been trending. It used to be a bellwether state. It is not. It has been trending Republican. Yeah, Sherrod Brown hangs in there. He's a weird kind of Democrat who appeals to the old kind of working class Democrat. He is a good candidate. I make no judgments here about these candidates. I'm just telling you politically what I'm seeing. So don't shoot the messenger. All right, a couple of things to keep in mind. In most of the Senate races is not going to be very competitive, and this has been something that has been increasing for years. This is the percentage of Senate race winners from the same party as the state's most recent presidential winner. So if Joe Biden won in 2000 in a particular state, and this is why we mentioned Ron Johnson, it's almost certain that the Senate candidate of that party is going to win in that state as well. There were 100% of them in 2018, and 97% of the Senate races went that way in 2020. So if you're Ron Johnson, you want to worry about running in a state that Joe Biden won. Another way of thinking about this is this top group here. These are states, the percentage of Senate seats, or the number of Senate seats that have split delegations, and they are at the lowest level since we've been electing we've been directly electing Senate. So just not a lot of split delegations going on either. So it really means that most of these Senate races are not going to be nearly as competitive as they used to be. This is where candidates come into play. And I don't mean to cast aspersions on any of these candidates, but this is Blake Masters, Mesut Oz, and Herschel Walker. They're all in eminently winnable states. In fact, I would have said generically the Republicans should win all three of these states. But the reality is all three of these candidates have baggage, whether it's a carpetbagger charge or... where do I start? And even Masters has had to soften his views on abortion in light of a lot of decisions and trying to portray himself as more moderate than maybe he was. It's unclear if he's going to do that. So it is possible that these Senate races that are eminently winnable, once again, Republicans will snatch defeat from the jaws of victory. All right, so I've led you down the garden path. I'm here to give you my forecast to see if I get invited back again, to see if your money is worth anything. And I'm going to say one thing, and this is going to sound like I'm waffling here, because I am. There's normally a bunch of political science forecast models released at about this time, and I rely heavily on them. They haven't come out yet. So I'm a little less certain about my forecast, but I'm going to give it to you anyhow in the spirit of fair play. Let's start with the House, shall we? I'm predicting Republicans to gain 28 seats. So falling below that 30 threshold, but I think in the end, the out-party momentum that typically sees is going to start moving that generic ballot a little bit more. I don't think there's much more the Democrats can do between now and November in terms of passing legislation. They've gotten much of the boost that they're going to get. And so I think this is the Republicans' year. That's not a huge gain, and that's because, again, there's just not a lot of competitive seats. But maybe 30 to 40 competitive seats, but they're going to win more than half of those competitive seats. And that will be enough to give them about 240 total seats, depending on how those vacancies are filled. That's enough to have a working majority if they can hold their coalition together. The big worry for them is the Senate. And here I'm going in the other direction. I think the Republicans are going to win four of those contested seats, but one is the flip. I think they're going to flip Nevada. I think the Democrats are going to win five of those contested seats, including two that will flip, Pennsylvania and Wisconsin. And that will give the Democrats a net gain of one. So we are looking towards divided government. Joe Biden presiding, and frankly, if you want to lose one seat, one chamber, you want to lose the House. The Senate, you're still going to be able to get judges through for another 2 years if you can hold your party together. A big if for the Democrats. Now, in case you don't believe the forecast models, I'll show you. I like to make fun of the pundits. I spend a lot of time making fun of the pundits. But the pundits weigh in, so let me tell you what they're predicting. Not necessarily these pundits. These are the ones I really make a lot of fun of. Sean Trende at RCP, Real Clear Politics. We've reached the end of the second quarter, so this is now several months late, but he as at this point, you have to see the Republicans as overwhelming favorites to take the House and strong favorites to take the Senate. I think he might modify that now. Harry Enten, CNN, my estimate for the 2023 House makeup, if the election were held today, Republicans 236 to 241, so he's in my ballpark. Democrats 194 to 199. David Wasserman, the Cook Report, he's really fudging it. The Republicans are gonna gain 20 to 35 seats. Geez, I did better than that. I gave you a point estimate. Anyone can say 20 to 35 seats. So you can tell the pundits, the people who sort of look at each individual race and try to handicap them, are in line with our forecast models, if that gives you any additional House. Now, they're not making Senate predictions, but generally they're saying the House will go Republican by 20 to 30 seat pickup. All right, why do we care? Well, we care because it affects Biden's ability to govern, right? And there's all sorts of things we can talk about, and I'll leave this to the question and answer. Got about half an hour here. So I won't spend too much time on the implications of a split government. But note this, the percentage of bills passed by Congress that were backed by a president when Congress is controlled by the president's party is pretty high, about 83%. The percentage of bills passed by Congress when one or both houses of Congress is controlled by the other party drops to 56%. So the first implication is Joe Biden's legislative agenda will grind to a halt unless he focuses on issues that can attract bipartisan support. If he can't, he'll have to rely heavily on executive orders, much as Barack Obama did after 2010. And there are limits to your ability to change policy unilaterally through executive orders and administrative rules. Just breaking that down more closely, during his first 2 years as president, Donald Trump's success rate in 2017 and 18 was 98% and 93%, mostly because he did everything Mitch McConnell told him to do. Didn't really have much independent influence. If McConnell didn't want him to do something, Trump didn't do it. But once they lost control, his percentage of success dropped. Obama, same thing, up in the 90s, even 88, and then down to 56 after the shellacking. What does it say about 2024? It says nothing about 2024. Pundits after the midterm are going to talk about which party has momentum and what it says about 2024. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. It says nothing about the presidential election. That has no implications. If we look at the winner of the midterms over the last 19 presidential elections, the party that won the midterm went on to win the presidency 10 times. The party that lost the midterm went on to win the presidency 9 times. So it says nothing. All right. What do you want to look at? I'll preview, if Gloria invites me back, my presidential forecast. It's the economy, stupid. That's the most important thing, although there is some evidence that the impact of the economy is lessening in recent elections, but that's for another talk. But generally speaking, if the economy is growing from the end of 2023 into the first two quarters of 2024, good news for Joe Biden or whoever runs as a Democrat. If it's shrinking, bad news. That's the first thing we're going to look at heading into 2024. But that's for another talk, another day. Let's stop here with this thought. If the election were held today, who would you vote for? That's one poll, folks, and that's from March. But I just threw that out there because I thought a lot of you were, you weren't worried, but now I give you something to worry about. All right, let me stop there. Thank you. And let's open it up for questions.
I take it that you don't have a concern for changes in voting regulations in the red states, which have been promoted recently in the last year.
Well, I do have a concern. The question was about quote unquote voter suppression efforts by Republicans. And There are a number of changes that were made to election laws that cut both ways. And depending on your partisan inclination, you support some of them, you oppose some of them. And while I think these are important issues that get to the heart of democracy, they have much less impact on vote outcome than you might think. In part because a lot of these changes actually cut in different ways. So it's not just Republicans who are engaging in things like voter ID, but in many blue states, we're moving towards early voting. And I'm making no judgment on any of these things. There's the defense of both sides can make a principled defense for why they're doing what they're doing. But the thing that we're interested in is, does it affect our forecast models? And the short answer is not really, it doesn't. Part of the reason is things like vote by mail, we've had enough practice with states doing this, like in Washington, in Oregon, in Colorado, in portions of California, to assess whether it favors one party or the other. It turns out it doesn't. Early voting used to favor Republicans a little bit. In recent years, it hasn't as much. Interestingly enough, early voting actually depresses turnout, believe it or not, allowing individuals to vote early. It's counterintuitive, but when you think about it, what happens is when people are voting piecemeal early, you don't build up to that crescendo in which everybody is talking about the election and who are you going to vote for. You kind of diminish that a little bit. And instead, parties have to work on getting people out to vote continuously. And so it sort of minimizes their ability to turn out. So early voting actually depresses turnout, but it doesn't necessarily favor either voting. Vote by mail, on the other hand, increases turnout. But it doesn't necessarily favor either party. And I think the concern you might have is things like voter ID laws. And that we know suppresses turnout. But again, it's not necessarily clear what the implications are. It generally hurts lower income voters, but it hurts lower income voters who vote Republican, and increasingly, lower educated, lower income voters are moving into the Republican column. In fact, that's the big switch in the support of the two parties. It's that education movement. It's particularly white working class voters that were solidly Democrats, the New Deal coalition, they have been gradually moving into the Republican Party. So when you do voter ID laws, you're actually hurting their turnout. So I have a concern about whether these increase turnout or not, but the partisan implications are more complicated than you might have thought if you're watching those pundits that I showed before who just rail every night about how the one party or the other is stealing the elections by changing the laws.
Is there any correlation between fundraising and voting?
Yes.
And
there is some evidence that fundraising reflects enthusiasm, and so the more enthusiastic party generally raises more money. The question is, where does that money go? We know that in contrast to presidential races, when you get into the general election, the fact that one candidate has got $1.2 billion and the other candidate has $1 billion, it doesn't really matter. The money makes no difference. It makes a big difference in Senate and House races, particularly open seats. But the problem is most of that money is spent on behalf of incumbents. And the reality is, after a certain point, you're just wasting dollars. You really want to target money on challengers because the bang for the buck is bigger for challengers than it is for incumbents. And so money matters a lot, but the question is, which party is going to be more effective at funneling that money into key races? For instance, if I'm the Republican House Committee, I'm not going to send any money to Vermont. Because it's a waste, right? You're not going to flip Vermont's seat. So right now, 2018, the Democrats as a party outraised the Republicans, and we think that helped them. I came in here and forecast that they were going to pick up 31 seats or something like that. They picked up 40. And we think a lot of that was the enthusiasm gap translating into money that they were able to target a lot of those races. So I probably should have showed you a slide right now on the money race. It's pretty close. I think Democrats are slightly ahead again, which helps them, but it's not, they're not ahead by a lot enough that I think it's going to overcome these sort of the headwinds they're facing. I probably should have showed you a slide on that, though.
Do your comments about Kansas and abortion mean that you agree with the surveys that show that abortion is no more important than, say, fourth, fifth, or sixth in importance in terms of voting?
As a general rule of thumb, most individuals, when asked, for instance, to just list the three most important issues for them when they're voting in the midterm, abortion does not make that list. Now, it briefly began to appear on that list after the Supreme Court decision. There was a lot of salience there, and the Democrats are trying to keep that issue salient. But as voters begin to pay attention, I expect that salience is going to recede, and the more pocketbook fundamental issues that drive elections, particularly inflation, gas prices, which by the way are coming down, but food prices are not. So I am one of those who have cautioned Democrats not to rely on abortion as an issue that's going to flip this for them.
I have two questions, not quite related, but I'm interested in both of their impacts on your forecasting models. One is Gen Z voting.
Gen Z voting. Yes, the Generation Z?
Yeah.
Yep.
And the second is ranked choice voting in Alaska and Maine.
Yeah. Great question. So ranked choice voting, remember I talked about simple plurality, simple member, simple plurality voting. It doesn't hold everywhere. Maine has switched over to ranked choice voting. In this special election, Alaska, to replace Don Young, remember that vacant seat? I probably should have corrected that because he actually has been replaced briefly until November. A Democrat actually won using ranked choice voting, finished ahead of two Republicans because the two Republicans cannibalized each other's votes. And do you remember who one of those Republicans was? Yes, Tina Fey. Tina Fey was running. Sarah Palin was running. But it's almost certainly the case that a Republican is going to actually win in November when they don't use ranked choice voting. The problem with ranked choice voting, you know how ranked choice voting works? For those of you who, it essentially, rather than first past the post, whoever gets your vote, that's it. You rank your preference for candidates. So say, okay, I want Becca Ballant, but then I would put Molly Gray, and then I would put Gerald Malloy, or if I'm screwing up the races again. And what you do is when the votes come in, that if that the candidate who finishes last, all his votes are thrown out, the people who voted for him, and we look at who they had second on their list. And they all go and get reallocated to the other people. And then whoever's last, they get thrown out, and they get reallocated until you basically have a winner. A lot of people argue that ranked choice voting, and it's been in use in other countries and in state and local elections. Burlington used to use ranked choice voting, and then they got away from it, and then they were trying to get back to it. The idea is you can measure intensity of preferences, but it hasn't really worked well because people are confused by it. And so I don't think ranked choice voting is going to really come into play here in a way that's going to affect these forecast models if it becomes more prevalent and people pay more attention to it. The youth vote is Gen Z. I always get I'm beginning teaching next week, and I'd like to know which generation my students are. Are they part of Gen Z? I'm on Z. What happens when we run out of the letters? I have to go to Greek letters. So one thing we know about the young people, or the youths of America, as I call them, is they are almost certainly going to have the lowest turnout of any group. They just don't vote. And that's not because they're apathetic, it's because they're often not registered to vote, they're often living in areas in which they don't know where the polling booth is and everything. However, at the margins, they have been tending Democrat in recent years. And so to the extent that they are going to affect this outcome at the margins is probably to boost Democrats. except that they're not big fans of Joe Biden. And so the worry you have for Democrats is that they're just not going to vote in a midterm. So if I'm a Democrat, I'm Nancy Schumer, and I am resting my hopes that Gen Z is going to pull my fat out of the fire, dream on, teen queen. You know, the student debt issue, and again, I'm in the wrong crowd here. I'm a plumber. I'm paying my mortgage. You know, I got to borrow money to pay my health bills. And then some rich kid who went to college took out loans, and suddenly those loans are getting paid off. That doesn't sit right with me at all. So I think the student debt thing is a wash, frankly. I just don't think the way that it's being portrayed as being a big boost for Democrats, it just feeds right into that cleavage between the working class vote that has been trending Republican and the sort of higher education, higher income vote, which has been doing Republican, has been moving Democrat. This issue just, it crystallizes those divisions. So I just don't see this as a winning issue for Democrats if they think it's going to, again, flip these dynamics.
Thank you. I never quite understood what the hullabaloo was over the voting ID, since there is very little one can do without an ID. If there's something important that we can do with an ID, without an ID that you know of that I don't, maybe you can tell me.
Well, so the defenders of photo ID, it depends on what constitutes an ID. The defenders point out in most nations of the world, you have to have some version of an ID in order to vote. I'm not defending this or not, but the reality is, depending on what constitutes a form of ID, there are certain classes of individuals who are less likely to have one. People who don't drive, who are more likely to rent, who are unemployed, who move a lot. So it has a discriminatory effect on a certain class of individuals. Is that good? Is that bad? I don't know, but we political scientists have studied this, and it does have a disproportionate impact on people of lower socioeconomic status. It just does. Now, I cast no moral judgment on whether that's good or bad, but it does. Yeah?
You do need an ID to cash a welfare check.
Yeah, the percentage of individuals who are on unemployment who vote is vanishingly small. I'm more interested in individuals who are working but who are renting, who are moving. Yeah, take public transportation, don't have licenses. It's just the fact that IDs disproportionately impact some voters. Have I exhausted you? I have. With 6 minutes, oops, we got one more.
In your various models, how do you factor in what I'm calling media bias? The fact that in various markets you have very strong media favoring one side or the other, which does have an influence in what people perceive as the major issues, because some media don't cover certain things and some media do. So how in your analytics do you factor in that sort of phenomenon?
So there's a couple of ways in which you might think media matters. One is those ubiquitous ads that individual candidates are running. That's a form of media. So I mentioned Maggie Hassan. You can't turn on the television without Maggie's face showing up, and she's not even in Vermont. And we're just gonna see more and more of that. So we've done studies of that type of media coverage. And it turns out individuals, the shelf life of an effective ad is a little less than a week and a half. So in other words, we show ads to individuals, ask them what they think about it, and then we come back in a week and a half and ask them again about that ad, and they can't even remember seeing it. And their views, whatever view was influenced by that ad, reverts back to what it was before the ad. This isn't to say the ads are completely ineffective. Over time, they can frame an election in a certain way, though, so the voters think this is what the election is about. But it doesn't change people's minds. It, at best, helps promote turnout. The media coverage, the so quote-unquote press, we've done extensive studies of their coverage. And the most important thing about the media coverage is it has become increasingly negative over the last several decades and increasingly focused on the horse race. So the degree that it matters, that it influences an election, is that it comes through its effort to handicap the race. And the worry, of course, is if they say one party is so far ahead that this race isn't going to, it's not competitive, then you might depress turnout. But that's usually at the margins. The idea that they can, they have a bias towards one party or other, we find much less evidence of that being true. You know, you tend to think about, geez, if everybody watches Fox News and Sean Hannity, they're just going to get an entirely skewed view of the world. Or Rachel Maddow in MSNBC, they're going to get a skewed, well, yes, they get a skewed view, but you know how many people watch those programs? Very few, very few. You might get in a midterm over 100, let's see, what did we have? We had 150 million votes in the presidential election, dropped 20% from that. What are you getting, about 110, something like that? About 3 million people watched Sean Hannity. 3 million, 4 million.
Less than that
now?
Who? Sinclair,
broadcasting. Well, there's all, it's balkanized among different groups. So the point is, there, once you get beneath the elites who just live and die, the 10% of the American, this is a whole other talk that I give, the 10% of Americans who are deeply polarized and wedded to their partisan views, who think the other side is evil incarnate, those are the only ones watching these cable news shows, and their views are already set in stone. They're not going to change. So those cable news shows have a lot less influence than you might think they do. They just don't switch voters so much as they preach to the choir.
And with that, we want to thank you.
Thank you. Don't forget, we do have competitive races in Vermont, believe it or not. So vote early and vote often.